All right, communicating the message of good health diet, the effect of diet on common diseases is a job that all of us have to do. Whether you happen to be a high school student or a teacher or a factory worker or a medical doctor or a nutritionist, we all have an obligation to share this message. I find that when I speak, people who are not doctors generally listen more carefully. Somehow or another, being in the same profession as a medical doctor, I get a little bit extra defensiveness from some of my colleagues. Not here in this room where there are a lot of medical doctors, but when I go out and speak at hospitals. But all the dietitians are listening, all the scientists are listening, they're not threatened. I think it's good to have people here that have the understanding about the importance of good nutrition from different disciplines. And to have somebody come here and talk about the importance of diet on health and disease and diabetes from a non-medical doctor point of view, from somebody who's a scientist, somebody who could represent the scientific literature from a less health-oriented, personal type of point of view, somebody who can look at really look at the hardcore science as an opportunity. And our next speaker I've known for at least 15 years. We got together initially when we started the Lifestyle Medicine Academy, American College of Lifestyle Medicine, back in, oh boy, when was that? That was a long time ago. We were part of the founding members of the American College of Lifestyle Medicine. American College of Lifestyle Medicine was supposed to be like the American College of Surgeons. You know, all these people who are interested in lifestyle medicine were supposed to get together and share with the rest of the world about the importance of, well, it's moving along and it's starting to make differences and so on. But our next guest, Dr. Wes Youngberg, and I were founding members of that, and we've kept in touch over the years, and he has become passionate from a scientific point of view about the treatment of diabetes. And his book, which we have many copies of for sale afterwards, is Goodbye Diabetes, is an excellent read. In fact, I think you'll find my name in it someplace here or there. I'd like to welcome Dr. Wes Youngberg. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. McDougall. Actually, we even go back further than that. Back in 1989, 1990, I had the privilege to be the president of the Loma Linda University Public Health Alumni Association. And the only real good thing about being president of that organization is that I get to pick all the speakers that come to the annual conferences. And so at that point, since I just started my clinical lifestyle medicine practice, I said, I want Dr. McDougall to come speak at this conference, because you see, back in the late 80s, early 90s, there wasn't much information available on how you treat disease naturally. There really wasn't that much. In fact, the best resource available to me is I was setting up my practice in the Loma Linda University faculty medical offices, where physicians and endocrinologists were referring to me, diabetics and other conditions. The only real resource I had available to me was McDougall's Medicine. How many of you have read that book from many years ago? McDougall's Medicine was an awesome review of how a vegan diet could address so many different things. In fact, I was on a plane coming back from a book signing about 3 weeks ago from Orlando, Florida. And the gentleman next to me, you know, everybody's interested in health. The gentleman next to me started engaging me, and he was reading a book on heart disease, and he started asking me, well, what do you do? So that's a great opportunity that we all have to be part of the solution, right? To just engage people. And so I told him what I did, and he says, well, okay, you know, can I look at your book? And so I said, sure. So I pulled it out of my briefcase, and I gave him my book. He started reading through it. After about 3 hours on the flight, he says, hey, now I don't have to buy your book, because I read it already. But he says, your book is not titled properly. He says, I thought this was just going to be good for people with diabetes, but this is good for everybody. And see, and if you've been going to McDougall's programs, right? I see you nodding. If you've been going to these programs even just once, you know that this diet is the solution for almost all, chronic disease. It's the number one solution. Right. Not in a vacuum, as we've clearly learned this weekend, but it has to be the pivotal point, or else we'll never hit that tipping point necessary to reverse anything or prevent anything. We have to be able to reach that tipping point, and this is the foundational work that is necessary for us as individuals who are seeking to forestall disability and death, right? As individuals who are wanting to increase the vitality that has been lost in part, but also to change the world. If we're going to be able to do that, we have to use this as the foundation. So when I give this talk to just general audiences, I call it Preventing and Reversing Diabetes and Pre-Diabetes, real important here, the natural way. But a little bit more sophisticated, we start talking about the epigenetic issue, right? Wasn't that exciting? Yesterday's understanding about epigenetics and how genes no longer are understood to be the determining factor in our health. Stop letting people get away with the idea of saying it's familial, right? What does that mean? It's familial, it's genetic. In other words, I really can't do anything about this. The only option available to me is medicine. Well, if a medicine can change this, that means that the gene is not causing the problem, right? If you can change it anyway, that means that that gene is plastic, meaning it's changeable, it's adaptable. We can change the expression of our genes by the choices that we make, by what foods we put into our mouths, by what fluids we put into our mouths, by what thoughts we think. All have a powerful influence on what's happening to our genes, turning them on, turning them off. It's like a dimmer switch. Every little choice that we make in the positive direction is gradually dimming that switch to that gene that causes cancer, inflammation, diabetes, heart disease, autoimmune disease. So we want to get busy impacting that dimmer switch and turning up the dimmer switch next to that gene that causes vitality and longevity, not just living longer and hurting longer, but living longer and feeling better, right? That's what empowers me and excites me about this whole concept. But when I'm lecturing to a group of health professionals or a group like you that includes many health professionals, but also highly educated consumers of healthcare, right? You're here because you're investing in your health. You want to really understand what works. So the lifestyle medicine approach. In fact, Dr. McDougall and I are both speaking in just over a month in D.C. at the annual American College of Lifestyle Medicine meetings, really focusing on how do we approach this lifestyle, nutritional medicine aspect? How do we encourage other health professionals to do the same thing? But so I'm going to be focusing today on redefining, really, what does this field have to contribute to understanding of the definition of diabetes, an understanding of diabetes, detecting it early enough so that we can have more and more people be able to reverse it quickly. Okay, and then defying diabetes. Okay, we no longer should we be, well, you know, I have diabetes. Must be God's will. Yeah, I've heard so many people say that. It's crazy that we're blaming God for the problem we have. Okay, for the poor choices that we're making or the lack of understanding relative to how powerful we are in the choices that we make. And then finally, defeating diabetes and pre-diabetes. Okay, but really, as I already pointed out, this is more than just diabetes. If you get this right, okay, if you are like if you're between 20 and 39, one out of two of you have at least pre-diabetes or die. Did you catch that? If you're between 20 and 39, it's one out of five of you. If you're between 12 and 19, it's 16% already have prediabetes. And these are conservative figures. These are from the studies that have been done, NIH and other organizations. If you're between 40 and 59, one out of two of you already have at least prediabetes. I shouldn't be saying you, because I know you are the outliers, right? You are the ones that are reversing this if you're applying what you know. And if you're between if you're between 60 and 74, 2 out of 3 within the U.S. population already have at least prediabetes. 75 and over, 3 out of 4, 75% of Americans over 75 already have at least prediabetes, and a full third of them are diabetics. Okay, so, but the real issue here isn't lowering blood sugars. Sounds kind of strange from somebody who's talking about reversing diabetes. It's really not all about blood sugars. Blood sugar is just one of the symptoms of a horrible metabolic mess. And so if I was smiling Friday as I listened to Dr. McDougall give his talk, talking about diabetes, I was just smiling and I was beaming because he set this talk up perfectly, because he said, if you focus on blood sugars alone and follow the path of least resistance, where you just say, well, if I can lower my blood sugars so effectively with just a pill or even insulin, then, you know, insulin is a lot easier than changing your diet, right? It's been said that changing your diet is harder than changing somebody's religion. It's not an easy thing, but when you see the power that it has over our genes, it's worth it, isn't it? Right? And so the issue here is that the diabetes is just the tip of the iceberg. Blood sugars is just a symptom. If you lower your blood sugars with a medicine, that looks good on paper, but what have you just done to your death rate? Your risk of dying prematurely. All the studies agree on this, right? 250% increased risk of dying prematurely. I remember I was talking to an endocrinologist 20 years ago, because this is not new data. This is the way it's always been in the medical literature. It's always been documented right there in the medical journals. So I asked an endocrinologist, a good friend of mine, who ran a very large diabetes center. I said, what about this? And he got kind of thoughtful. He said, well, you know, there was quite a few editorials after that those studies came out. And those writing the editorials really criticized that it just couldn't be that way. It just can't be true. Show me a study that says it's not true. It's not out there, right? And so we need to be willing to listen to the facts and then allow the facts to direct the choices that we make. So the real issues with diabetes is not blood sugars, it's the fact that the metabolic mess is dramatically increasing the risk of heart attack, strokes, erectile dysfunction, atherosclerotic conditions, hypertension, autoimmune disease, you name it. Just whatever you want to list to that, headaches, all kinds of problems. So we need to address the underlying cause of the diabetes, not just the blood sugars. I'm not against aggressive management of blood sugars. It just has to be done the right way, or else you'll actually get worse, right? That's the challenge. So what motivates me? When I was 10 years old, I was living in South America. I was actually in Bolivia, beautiful place in the valley. We were at 8,500 feet above sea level, overlooking 17,000 foot peaks in the Andes. My parents are Christian missionaries in South America. One day I saw my dad drive home about 2:30 in the afternoon. He was a president of a university there, and we never saw him in the afternoon. So my brother and I were throwing baseball back and forth. We saw him. We go, that's strange. What's he doing home? What's dad doing home? And as he walked towards us, we could see that he was crying. And that scared us. We didn't even know what was wrong, and already my brother, John, and I were crying, because we had never seen my dad cry. And he said, kids, just brought mom home from an appointment at a hospital, and the radiologist has just told us that we have to get mom to the States today. She had been diagnosed with a huge tumor in her brain. To make a long story short, that afternoon we flew to New York City, where my uncle, who is a physician, actually brought a car to the tarmac, just drove it right up to the airplane took my mother and immediately had her set up for surgery. It was glioblastoma. It was terminal. I mean, even today, 40 years later, there's very little hope conventionally for something like that. And to make a long story short, she was given 4 to 6 weeks to live. She lived 9 months. She was a fighter. 2 years later, I'm raking leaves with my father one autumn afternoon in Bering Springs, Michigan. There's a lot of leaves. After about 45 minutes of raking and raking, I started having one of those bonding moments with my father. And I said to my dad, I said, "Dad, why? Why did Mom have to die? What happened? We're such a healthy family." And so I was looking for answers. And I remember my dad not saying a word. He didn't know what to say to me. I was 13. And he leaned on his rake looking down Greenfield Drive there in our street. And it was then that I had a watershed experience in my life. I said, "Dad, I wish I knew right now what my risks are so that I could start doing something about it immediately, right now, and not have to go through what Mom went through and other relatives have gone through, dying of heart disease." And without realizing it, that changed my life. I immediately, as a 13-year-old, started reading every health book I could get a hold of. I became passionate about health. How do we optimize health? And it changed my life. I remember I wish I would have had Dr. McDougall to go to when I was a kid. Isn't this great? I have 15 aunts and uncles or cousins who are MDs. So all the pressure on me was to go through medicine. But I learned something real quick. Whenever I went to either one of my relatives who was a physician or to my own family doctor, and I would pose a question, I realized that I knew more about health than they did. Right? And so again, I chuckle listening to Dr. McDougall and others who basically went through the system and now are trying to change the system. And even, 30, 40 years later, the system still isn't teaching what is necessary. I'm on the faculty of the School of Medicine at Loma Linda University. So at least I'm on the faculty, and they rotate students and shadow me at my clinic to learn about nutritional medicine. Okay, but they're still not teaching it in the academic curriculum. It's crazy. And so that's why I chose to take the path less trod by within my family. And I chose to actually take a master's in nutrition and a doctorate in lifestyle medicine. I wanted to learn in my training what I was going to be doing. So that was my path. So that's what motivates me. So that's why I care about this, because I saw as a young boy the impact of bad decisions and the lack of knowledge. Just doing what your doctor told you to do ended up being leading to so many problems. Well, so that's why I wrote this book. You know, anybody who writes books, especially after the first one, knows that it's not to make lots of money. There's a lot better ways to make money than writing books. And so I thought, why would I want to do this? Why would I want to write a book? Well, because it's my opportunity, based on my experience, to help people who are looking for answers. And looking for understanding what the risk factors are to motivate the average person to make a change, right? That's what testing is all about, folks, okay? Is to give us some objective evidence like, wow, I need to change, right? I'll tell you why. When, in 1984, there was a national change in health policy where now cholesterol was considered to be a health problem. Prior to 1984, the average physician, when they looked at the lab ranges for total cholesterol, the normal cholesterols went from 130 to 320. You can look it up in any old paper chart, because I used to do a full lab reviews on every patient, and I'd go through the thick paper charts, and you could see all the labs prior to 1984, they all said normal cholesterol is 130 to 320. So if you had a cholesterol of 315, like I heard one lady say Friday night, that's normal. And guess what? It is normal statistically. It is normal. A lot of the labs that we currently see today are still focused on statistical normals. The last thing that we want to be health-wise right now is normal. Right? We want to be optimally healthy, and that is not normal. Right? We know that. Okay, so we cannot be normal anymore or think that that's even a good thing. It's not a good thing. And so in 1984, I was actually doing a talk as a student on this revolutionary, new, groundbreaking information where Drs. Brown and Goldstein won the Nobel Prize for Medicine because they established the mechanism by which cholesterol leads to inflammatory changes in the artery wall and atherosclerotic plaque. Wow, that was like nobody had heard about this before. 90% of physicians before that time thought this whole idea of cholesterol was stupid. There's nothing to it. Well, that's changed now, right? So I decided that I was going to get my cholesterol checked because, see, I'd been a vegetarian all my life. Now, I wasn't a vegan. I was vegetarian all my life. And I was a marathon runner, I was a gymnast, I thought of myself as Mr. Fitness, Mr. Health. I knew more about health than just about everybody else that I knew. And so I thought, I'm gonna be, I understood risk, right, from the classes I took. So I knew that to be in the optimal range, I would be like under 140 based on the current ranges back then for a 24-year-old man. I had my cholesterol checked, and my friend who worked in the hospital as a med tech, she came up to me and she said, wow, this isn't good. And I'm going like, yeah, right, come on, give me the paperwork. I thought she was messing with me, right? She wasn't, she was concerned about me. I go, no, give me that. And so I was expecting to be under 140, I was 244. Vegetarian all my life, but I wasn't vegan. My Mr. Fitness bubble that I'd been carrying as a young man, very proud of for so long, all of a sudden, because of a test, got popped. Okay? This is really, really critical. Okay? We have to go beyond the conceptual to change lives. We have to show them out of their own blood, out of their own risk factors, that if they don't change, they're going to continue on a path that will lead to premature disability and death and a lot of misery, a lot of unnecessary cost. That's the value of testing. But we have to apply the testing properly. We can't use statistical ranges. We have to use optimal ranges. We can't use a Band-Aid to treat lab values that are abnormal because the Band-Aids don't address the original cause of the problem. They just make you think you're better when in fact you're worse because of your approach. So I'm a big advocate of appropriate testing, which requires an appropriate approach of intervention. Okay, so in 1986, as a student at Loma Linda University, I went to a lecture by Dr. James Anderson. You heard Dr. McDougall talking about him already. An eminent endocrinologist, top of his field, published hundreds and hundreds of studies on diabetes and nutritional metabolism at the University of Kentucky in Lexington. It was top of his field. The problem was is that very few people were listening. He had such a huge impact on writing and publishing in the top medical journals in the country, in the world. And yet, you know, where's the public policy that matches, that's congruent with what he did back in the 70s? But I got to hear him as a student in my professional training. And when I saw what he was doing, reversing diabetes in a hospital, people laying in a bed all day, going on a starch-based, high-fiber diet, reversing their need for insulin and oral hypoglycemic medication, I was hooked. I said, why isn't this being taught everywhere? How come it takes a visiting professor to talk about this to encourage people to actually do what works, what is addressing the cause of disease? And so he was one of the giants that where I was a springboard, a stepping stone for me, and Dr. McDougall and others like him. So let's just jump right into it. The book is divided into four sections. Let's really understand diabetes and its underlying issues. It's not just a blood sugar issue. Okay? You can't just take a medicine and resolve diabetes and the risk associated with it. Why? Because taking the medicine makes it worse. Okay? Debunking diabetes. Y'all, you're going to have this for the rest of your life. Okay? If you take medications as your main approach to treating diabetes, you absolutely will have diabetes for the rest of your life because it'll become a growing cycle of increased resistance to insulin the entire time. You have to treat the cause or else you'll never get better. Detecting diabetes through appropriate and optimal testing. And the fourth part, and the main part of the book, is defeating. What do we do? How do we do this effectively? How do we take advantage of the things that we're learning in this conference and apply it at home most effectively? Okay, so I'm really stressed when I get an hour to give a talk because I do a 12-week, 90-minute-per-week seminar series on diabetes for my patients. So you know, that's, what is that, 18 hours of discussion and lecturing, and so... So I got to jump into this. But every single session that I do, I always start with this. What is diabetes? Diabetes is simply having a sugar level so high and for so long that they eventually cause significant health complications if not corrected. Now, it's not a complete definition, as I've already pointed out, but it's what sets the stage for us to be able to say that it's absolutely reversible. Because once your sugars no longer meet the definition of diabetes or pre-diabetes, guess what? You don't have it anymore. And you can't let anybody tell you that you do. Okay? And I'll expand on that in a little bit. So the diabetemic is huge that typically we say 8.3% of Americans have it. Okay? But if they do the right tests, if we just simply added the glucose tolerance test, which is after a sugar drink, you check your blood sugars, you know, on an insulin resistant state, if you take a sugar drink and your sugars go up above 140 at 2 hours, that's pre-diabetes. If it goes above 200 or higher at 2 hours, that's diabetes, and that's by far the most sensitive test. A full third of Americans today who have diabetes don't know it, even if they've had the standard medical test done every year. Why? Because a fasting blood glucose will not catch diabetes or pre-diabetes in the majority of patients. Adding the 2 hour, and especially the 1 hour, the most sensitive time, will really help us. So that takes it up to, if you do the after meal blood sugar test, that takes it up to 12.9% of Americans have just diabetes, and that increases the total burden of diabetes in the U.S. alone from 26 million to 40 million. Okay? And then another 79 million have pre-diabetes. All right, so 1980, less than 2.5% of Americans had diabetes. Fast forward to nowadays, it's we're looking at 13% or more, and those are conservative figures. So what's changed? Well, we've been learning this weekend what's been changing on that. Why? The complications of heart disease, ulcers that lead to amputations, circulation problems, kidney failure, dialysis need, and retinopathy, retinal detachment, and so forth. By the way, one of the great values of getting off meats completely, including fish, is that if you have any genetic tendency to hemochromatosis or a gradual buildup of iron in your blood, which is not that uncommon, if you have any tendency to that, That can actually be your biggest risk factor for heart disease in all these complications. And treating the blood sugars alone aren't going to change that risk. If you have elevated levels of ferritin or storage forms of iron in your blood. I had a patient who was a school teacher, and his wife was a manager of the medical group I was working with at the time. And he came in, he'd been managed with blood sugar control on various medications for 20 years. And he was like, it's like, dude, don't talk to me about not eating meat. That's the first thing he said to me. Okay, and he said, "No," he says, "I want to keep my energy up, and I'm not going to change my diet. I just want to. I'm here because my wife forced me to come." That's what he said. So I said, "Okay, so at least he was there, right?" So I did the broad testing on him, including the ferritin level, and I found that ferritin's supposed to be ideally around 100 or even a little less. His was 1,350. He was a bronze statue. I mean, he was just swimming in iron, which is a pro-oxidant, dramatically impacting his cancer risk, his heart disease risk, his diet. He had retinal detachment in one eye. And they kept saying, "Well, we just got to give you better blood sugar control." It didn't have anything to do with that. Primarily, it wasn't the primary problem, and so by doing the broad testing, he was able to find out what the main risk factor was. Now, what's the number one most logical treatment approach for somebody who's got tons of iron floating around their body? Stop eating foods that are super high in iron that easily come off of the food. And what's that? Meats, flesh foods, anything that's got blood pumping through it at some point in their life is going to have a lot of iron. So that's why this diet, it transcends the common risk factors that we look at. It helps everything. Okay, so I heard Norman Cousins speak years ago. He was in charge of the UCLA health program. It was a kind of a lifestyle program. But it didn't really take on the full elements that we're embracing here. Great guy. He was really into the aspect of psychoneuroendocrine immunology, the impact of how you think and how that influences your health. A very powerful and appropriate thing. We got to include that in our overall approach, stress management. Okay. But one of the most powerful things that he said, anybody here read Anatomy of an Illness? A few of you. It's a classic, 30 plus years old, but a classic where he says this: don't deny the diagnosis. In other words, when a patient comes to me and says, "Hey, I'm getting ready to see my cardiologist or my gastroenterologist, what do you think?" I say, "Well, the more information, the better." He says, "But," I give him a warning, "but just because you get a diagnosis, that's valuable information, doesn't mean you have to accept their answer to treatment." Right? I mean, that's what we've been learning this weekend, right? He said, you got to be in charge of your health. You are the chairman or the chairwoman of the board of your health. Nobody else. Not me, not your primary doctor, not anybody. It's you. And if you're not willing to be in charge, you're not going to do that well. Okay? If you don't learn, like we heard earlier, to just say no, okay, or I'll think about this, I'll talk to my board of advisors, and I'll get back to you, okay? If that offends your doctor or whoever is on your healthcare board, fire them and get somebody who's willing to work for you, right? Real, real critical. So don't deny the diagnosis. Defy the verdict. What we're learning right now is the solution to all those diagnoses. The primary solution, the foundational solution that has to be there for us to be effective. So the metabolic mess, that huge metabolic problem that underlies disease, needs to be addressed with the insulin resistance. We'll get into the sugar sticking. Right? Sticking to things. And so that's why we got to watch what happens to our blood sugars after the meal. and why an after-meal blood sugar is far more telling about our metabolic health than a fasting blood sugar. Far more critical. By the way, I always ask patients if they have any tendency to high blood pressure. Chances are, more often than not, that they have insulin resistance. Their muscles and their liver have become desensitized to insulin. So now, in order to control blood sugars, if they can, their pancreas has to produce lots of insulin. Now, I had an 18-year-old in my office just a week and a half ago, concerned about her health. She had digestive issues. She was already really trying to clean up her overall health. But we actually did a 4-hour glucose tolerance test on her. Her blood sugars were all perfect. But if we had just stopped there, we go, wow, your blood sugars are great, your metabolism's great. She had struggled with a tendency to high triglycerides. 18 years old, cheerleader, you know, fit. But she was having issues with, you know, exercise intolerance. She'd get fatigued when she exercised, unusually so. She was depressed. What's going on? She's going into her freshman year of college. You can't go into your freshman year of college feeling ill. And so we did the full test, and we discovered a lot of things, but we discovered that her insulin, after she had a little bit of sugar, her insulin levels, instead of going up a normal amount, shot up 10 times higher than normal. Okay, that's the earliest clue, even way before after-meal blood sugars. So that's why I, for 20 years now, have been testing insulin. By the way, Dr. Nancy Bohannon, an endocrinologist at UCSF, has been there for many, many years. She did a lecture for Family Practice Audio Digest that was given to me by one of the family docs at my clinic who liked what I did. She said, Wes, I think you'd be interested in this. This is 1991. And she basically said that the earliest metabolic imbalance for individuals who are at risk of heart disease, cancer, and diabetes is an elevated insulin level right after a meal. Okay, so a lot of things going on here. So we have that whole metabolic syndrome that we've been learning about that looks at waist circumference and how good your HDL, triglycerides, blood pressure, etc. is. That's another clue. There's the headache connection. Okay, Dr. McDougall's been saying this for 30 years. One of the best ways to get rid of headaches is what? Change your diet. Why? One of the main reasons is because it lowers the insulin production after the meals when you change your diet. Back in 1993, I was a neurologist who was working on a second degree, shadowed me in Southern California. She just spent a couple days with me. And, you know, I was working with diabetics, heart patients, etc. And what she picked up was something totally different than I was focusing on. She said, hey, have you been listening to your patients? So over the last 10 patients, 4 of them were excited about the fact that they didn't have headaches anymore. And I was just going like, yeah, everything looks better. You know, I was just kind of like, yeah, that's great. I didn't realize I'd never had a headache in my life. So I didn't realize how important it was for people to feel so much change once they change their diet and change their insulin resistance. She was so, as a neurologist, she was so excited about this. She said, Wes, can you help me put together my research project for my PhD? I said, sure. So I was on her committee, and she actually did research showing that if you change your diet, the same diet we've been talking about, and address and lower the insulin production after the meal, that the intensity, the duration, and the frequency of headaches plummeted. She published it in Medical Hypothesis 20 years ago. Amazing. Now she's a professor at UC Irvine. So it's critical for our health. Now, one of the biggest things that motivates us is that big C word. That's what motivated me. My mother died at age 39. She didn't get to see her little kids grow up. I didn't get to have her as I was growing up. She could still be with us today. But one of the biggest risk factors that isn't getting much buzz, even though there's literally thousands of studies documenting this, is that insulin, whether it's injected or whether it's produced in excess in our bodies because of poor lifestyle nutritional choices, is one of the main driving factors in promoting cancer. Now, just in January of this year, the journal Diabetes Care, which is the big journal, medical journal for diabetes management in the world, came out with a study, a huge study, a study you can't argue with, a huge study that supported what we've already known for 40 years. 25 years ago, I did a Medscape search on the relationship between insulin production in the body and breast cancer. I stopped looking after 700 studies. I go, okay, I get it. There's it just never ends. There's so many studies showing the connection between a lifestyle that causes your pancreas to have to produce extra insulin in order to control blood sugars. So here, the point is, don't just control your blood sugars. Do it in a way where your pancreas doesn't have to overwork and get fatigued. Do it in a way that's actually good for your body. Don't just think that taking that medicine is going to fix everything, because it doesn't. It actually increases your insulin production, unless it's metformin. Metformin, by the way, is the only medicine that lowers cancer risk when used as prescribed. All the other medicines for diabetes increase cancer risk. Why isn't that promoted? They think that people would want to know that. Wow, okay? So this big study that just came out shows that current insulin users were 30 to 50% at greater risk of developing cancer, and it was in 2 years. And so the diabetologists, I have many friends who are diabetologists, they were up in arms and said, this is crazy. You can't get cancer in 2 years. They're missing the point. They're totally missing the point. Says that we all from time to time, especially if you're on the standard American diet, have little cancers growing in us. Well, if the immune system is robust enough, if we're doing something right, then the body should be able to kill that off and get rid of it. But not if we're swimming in insulin and other unhealthy chemicals from our diet. If we're producing lots of insulin, what's an anabolic hormone that's going to drive all the data? You know, just look at the research. All the data shows this. It gets very little play. In fact, I've never seen this discussed in the media. Has anybody seen it discussed in the media? I have never seen this discussed, and yet it's all over the medical literature. And so the study was profound. Men were 60% more likely to develop cancer if they had had diabetes for 15 years using insulin. Okay, women 80% more likely. Women were twice as likely to develop breast and reproductive cancers. Okay, is this a good reason to share this information with your neighbor, with your coworker, with your family member? Said, we're talking about cancer here. Men were three times. I mean, when you read a study that says 20% increased risk of cancer if you do this, you pay attention. We're talking about 300% here. Okay, more likely to develop colon cancer. Breast, prostate, and colon cancer are the big three that relate to the metabolic syndrome. And if we focus on treating diabetes or pre-diabetes now with just medication, we're potentially setting ourselves up for serious increased risk of cancer. Men were 60% more likely to develop skin cancer. I thought that was caused by being in the sun, Dr. McDougall. Right? I love one of the talks. The first talk that you gave, American College of Lifestyle Medicine, was on MS and how that is so important that we get regular sun exposure and optimized vitamin D levels. Yeah, we got to look at the big picture here. And so sun exposure? No. If you want to stop skin cancer, get your metabolism under control. Yeah, make good decisions about how much sun you get, but you're far more likely to make a mistake to get inadequate sun than to get too much sun. Did you know that? So women were 120% more likely to get skin cancer. We're talking about melanoma. So if you're following the McDougall plan, if you're following this dietary strategy, incorporating lifestyle strategies, you're well on your way to preventing all these cancers. helping your body fight the ones that are starting to brew. Yeah, because it takes 10, 15 years for many of these cancers to actually show up. So let's defy this. Let's defeat it. Let's get rid of these little cancers that are growing in our bodies by making choices that deal with the cause of the problem. So that study caused Dr. Lee, that one of the principal researchers of this huge study, said these results support the notion that exposure to a high circulating concentration of insulin might result in mitogenic effects on the breast tissue that stimulate the growth of endometrial stromal cells. In other words, if your body has to produce more insulin to control your blood sugars, you're a sitting duck for cancer. And it could be one of the earliest ways to assess your risk for cancer. So that's why I personally, ever since I heard Dr. Nancy Bohannon's talk in 1991, I've always checked insulin on my patients during a glucose tolerance test. Fasting is good, but it's better to do it at 1 or 2 hours because that's when you're going to see the most sensitive indication. Okay, prostate cancer is related. I mean, this is crazy. Now, in 1995, I had the privilege to work with a large medical center in Guam for 14 years. I couldn't stay in paradise forever, so I decided to come back to California. But while I was there, the governor of Guam, part of his re-election campaign, brilliant man, he says, I want to have, as one of my four pillars of my re-election campaign, have a task force for the prevention of diabetes on Guam. I remember after all this was done, and I was asked to co-chair the task force for the governor, and so we came up with all these guidelines, and I was sitting with a physician who lived in Laguna Beach, a great guy. He was just contracting with the government for a few weeks, and we went out for Thai food. Let's get good vegan food at Thai restaurants, right? And so we were talking, and he said to me, he says, Wes, I says, so you wouldn't believe what I just saw in the paper today. There was this governor's task force thing saying that you could prevent diabetes, and he laughed. And so I kind of looked at him and chuckled. I says, well, you know, I was the author of that. And yeah, he was an ER doc, right? You know, he's a good guy, ER doc. But as you know, just because you're good at what you do doesn't mean you know a lot about the things that actually cause the problems, right? And so he kind of gulped, you know, and he looked at me. He's really funny, a good jokester. He says, well, I guess you have something to tell me then. Maybe there's something I don't know. You know, he was willing to accept the fact, well, okay, maybe what I learned in medical school wasn't all that accurate after all. All right, so what we did is I asked a question. He says, wow, you know, in Guam, when I first got there, they said, you're going to do what? You're going to actually talk to people in Guam about their diet, you know, where spam is king, literally, okay? Where you know, they you know, vegetables are, well, you know, at that point, they didn't even know what vegetables were. I mean, it was really bad. And part of it was because of all the typhoons that go through and the fact that when Guam was retaken during the war, one of my patients, when he found out I was going to Guam back in 94, he says, man, last time I was in Guam, he says, we just blew the crap out of it. I mean, that's what he said. There were ships on the, you know, around Guam. They were just made sure that there was going to be no resistance, right? Even though there was still a lot of loss of life. I mean, there was just no trees, there was no garden, there was nothing. So what did they eat? Well, whatever we brought in for them to eat, which was what? GI rations. Boy, that was healthy. That was a great decision to export health and improve vitality to the Pacific, right? So they said, they're not going to listen to you. You know, never accept that because they will listen. Because if you're logical, if they see your compassion, if they see that what you have is right, and then they look at you and they go, wow, look how this transformed you, I want that for myself. Never let people dissuade you about that. Well, over my 14 years there, I was able to make a huge impact on the island. But what one of the biggest impacts was how it impacted other medical doctors and health professionals. And so how can you prevent a condition on anywhere when the diagnostic criteria don't even allow you to catch the problem before there's complications, right? And so that's why we came up with the five stages of high blood sugars that precede diabetes, right? If you don't have somebody telling you, hey, you know, you're on the wrong path, okay, then you're going to be going over the cliff with the rest of everybody else when the diagnosis occurs, right? So you have to understand you're on the path to the cliff that's going to lead to falling under rocks in the ocean shore, right? So we need to provide good preventive guidelines. And so these are the stages that are outlined in detail in the book, and I don't have a lot of time left, so I'm going to just jump through this. So understand that we can catch this far earlier and pay attention to this. Okay, so there's various tests. It's important to understand, as I pointed out, that the pancreas can control blood sugars for decades, but in a way that places us at risk the entire time. So don't just rely on normal blood sugar levels. Focus on what's optimal and evaluate that properly. One of the things I'd like to do at health fairs is tell people, go and have your favorite soda, or candies, and just come back in 45 minutes. We'll check your sugar then. I call it the Pepsi Jelly Bean Challenge. Why? Because for pregnant women, I ran a gestational diabetes clinic for 7 years. Pregnant women who develop diabetes, okay, we want to catch that early, right? Okay, a lot of women can't handle that sugar drink, so we just give them jelly beans. It's all research. As long as you give them enough sugar to standardize the test. So the Pepsi Jelly Bean Challenge, just a term I came up with, says when you eat those type of foods, it's what causes blood sugars to go up, but the problem is the insulin that comes afterwards. Okay, all kinds of different tests that will... So debunking diabetes. Is there a cure for type 2 diabetes? Wrong audience to ask it was. Right audience to ask the question. Okay, you know the answer to this, but if you go to the prevailing medical paradigm, we see American Diabetes Association, there is no cure for diabetes. Wow, that's really helpful, isn't it? In other words, don't even try. Just take this medicine. It might cause you to die earlier, but at least your blood sugars would be better. You know, this is dangerous, Dr. McDougall, for me to be at your program, because for some reason I'm saying things that I would not normally say in that way. So you're a very dangerous person to be with. Can you cut that section out of the tape, please? U.S. Natural Library of Medicine, diabetes is a lifelong disease. You're going to have this what? For the rest of your life. There's no cure. Mayo Clinic, wow. Good job, Mayo. Okay, there's no cure for type 2 diabetes. We apparently don't read any literature on diabetes at the Mayo Clinic. Unthinkable. I shouldn't be shocked, but it's like, how can they actually say that and put it on the internet? Well, if you look at the speakers who've been here in this very podium, well, I feel feeling good. Just, I'm feeling good. Dean Norton, if you got diabetes, get rid of it. Joel Fuhrman, won't be controlling. No. We don't control anything. Why would anybody agree to just control some problem when you can get rid of it? You know, when you can become undiabetic. And then, of course, my favorite, our own Dr. McDougall, a simple cure is possible for essentially everybody. Just pay attention and follow through, right? So the biggest argument here is when somebody says, well, if I had a woman come into my office and she was 70 pounds overweight, she says, my goal is to get rid of my obesity. And I go, whoa, wait a minute. You know, I can help you lose 70 pounds, but you're still going to be obese. You see, once you're obese, you're always obese. You're controlling it, but you're still really obese. And she would look at me, and I hope she would say, you're crazy. I'm out of here. Like, what's wrong with you? That's so illogical. No. I'm the one with the training. And she should say, yeah, but you don't make any sense at all. I'm out of here. Okay, and so for us to say you can't cure diabetes is just as illogical as saying to people, that you can't really cure obesity. In other words, we want you to know you're sick, to know that there's nothing you can really do about it, and all you can do, well, just keep coming to see me. And I'll just keep telling you you can't cure it. Big disconnect there. Okay. Not doing real well on time. Dr. McDougall, I don't see a time prompter here, so I'm going to keep going until you pull me off the stage.
You've got 15 minutes.
Oh, all right. All right. Good. Saved. All right. Again, the diabetics' genetics. Man, if I had $100 for every time a patient told me, so it's genetic. Well, why are you here then? I don't say it that way. And the good news is that, remember, genes do not determine our health the vast majority of the time. Genes are only there waiting to express themselves one way or the other based on what? Based on the choices that you and I make. That's what the genes are doing there. Okay? Everything is genetic, right? It wouldn't happen if it was genetic. Everything is genetic, but we have control over our genes. We can master our genes. One of my favorite talks is genetic mastery. Wow, that's pretty cool, huh? We can master this. We don't have to just go through life thinking, well, woe is me. You know, why did God allow this to happen to me? You know, many of you have heard Dr. Randy Jurdal from Duke University. You know, powerful research with the fat yellow mama mice. You know, these mice that are genetically bred to have yellow coats, to become quickly obese, diabetic, hypertensive, heart disease, and many of them die prematurely of cancer. Wow, that's really great, researchers. Is there some way we can genetically engineer humans to have all those problems too? Well, wait a minute. I think we've figured it out. Just go to McDougall Advanced Study Weekend and then don't follow anything that you learn. That's how you genetically engineer humans to be just like these agouti, fat, yellow mice. So it is a powerful study because basically it was, about 15 years ago, there was an introduction to this understanding of epigenetics that non-genetic factors can actually turn on or turn off the genes that we're so scared of. We don't have to be scared of these genes anymore. See, if the gene was the main cause of diabetes, that these fat islanders in Nauru and all around the world would have been fat back in 1914 when Westernization first started having its influence in the Pacific. It's not, it's genetic, but genetics isn't the driving factor here. It's the choices, it's what we do with our genes. Okay, so let's quickly run through detecting diabetes. You know, we have warning signs. I'm in just 2 weeks, I'm doing a whole series of meetings for the Indiana University Health System. The CEO of the hospital saw my book and goes, "Let's do this." So they normally get 30 doctors out of hundreds in La Porte, Indiana, to actually come to anything. So we need to change the culture. Wow, a CEO that wants to change the culture of healthcare. Man, I love this. And so we're doing a huge talk for the community, inviting thousands of people to this big auditorium. It's actually a sports arena. But they're renting a big ballroom in the Blue Chip Casino, Michigan City, enticing these physicians to come and learn about something they never heard about before. Okay, and so they asked, well, this is a CME course, so we have to have questions. So, but that took me back 30 years. So let's do a multiple choice question on the diagnostic criteria for diabetes. And so I'll just jump through this real quick. So we got the fasting blood sugar of 126. Okay, how about a blood sugar of 200 or higher? Is that a current diagnostic criteria for the American Diabetes Association? A lot of doctors don't think that's true. Look it up, it's there. And it's, by the way, it's actually the most sensitive test. Without this test, you missed a third of people with diabetes. Okay, the worst way to get diagnosed with diabetes is for you just go to the doctor because you're not feeling well, and they check your blood sugar and it's above 200, and you've been like eating like a pig and losing weight. Okay, you've been always thirsty and always urinating. That's the worst way to get diagnosed. Why? That means you've had it for a long, long time. Maybe 20 years or so. I mean, this is a chronic, gradual, insidious disease. Let's catch it before it causes the heart attack or stroke or cancer, right? Not when you start feeling badly. Okay, and of course, the hemoglobin A1C, the sticky sugar pathology test. The A1C is not just a measure of how high your blood sugar has been for the last 3 to 4 months. It's a pathology test. That's why I check it on every patient. Because if you have sugar sticking abnormally to your tissues, that means that you have a trigger for your immune system to damage every part of your body. I don't want that in my body. So even though I might look fit and I might look optimally healthy, if I don't pay attention to the big picture, my A1C goes higher than it should. It keeps me motivated being aware of these things. So, second question I'm asking this group of physicians. List the following diagnostic criteria in order the greatest to the lowest sensitivity for diagnosing diabetes. I've already given you the answer. Okay? So, in other words, if we don't catch it early, we're doing our patients a disfavor. Okay? And so, what's interesting, the whole purpose for CME is to learn something you didn't know already. Okay, and most clinicians don't understand this. They would fail this part on their medical boards, if it ever gets to their medical boards. Okay, so make sure that we're aware of this insulin-resistant issue. And then prediabetes, 90% of people with prediabetes do not know they have prediabetes. Prediabetes is not just a risk factor to pay attention that you might in the future have diabetes. It is already a condition that tells us that there's a metabolic imbalance that's aggressively driving atherosclerotic changes in the body. So prediabetes needs to be managed aggressively. But see, the challenge, I know why this prediabetes became an official diagnostic criteria in 1997. Just like why cholesterol became an issue in 1984. Why? Because now there was a drug to treat it. I understand that. But that's not a reason to give up on this concept of early detection. Okay? We need to use that information and apply lifestyle nutritional medicine strategies to it. I love this when they say this. Nine years ago, I was asked by a president of a regional medical society to give a talk. And I said, well, what do you want me to talk about? He said, Wes, I'd love for you to talk about reversing diabetes with nutrition. I went, wait a minute, there was 500 physicians and other health professionals coming to this conference from all over the Pacific, the whole Pacific Rim. And the Ring of Fire, I mean, all over the Pacific. And so I go, you sure? You want me to talk about reversing diabetes with nutrition? I mean, I'm not McDougall, you know? I can't take the flaming arrows. Like, you know, I'm not sure, you know, I don't want to have to walk out of the room backwards, you know? And so he said, no, Wes, they'll love it, it'll be great. So I said, okay. So at the beginning of my talk, he gave me 90 minutes, I said, I'm just going to start my talk by saying, hey, you know, this wasn't my idea. It was the president of the medical society, right? It was his idea. So then I went on to give what I thought was a really good talk on reversing diabetes. The chairman of the scientific committee stands up, presumably to take questions for me. He's a nephrologist, okay? Nothing derogatory about nephrologists, but they do not see people reversing diabetes. Why? Because they get him at the very end, right? He ran 3 dialysis units. He said, before we take any questions for Dr. Youngberg, I just want to go on record. As the chairman of the scientific board, that I completely disagree with what Dr. Youngberg just presented. There was 500 people, a double ballroom. I'm looking at them, I'm looking at him. They're like looking at me, looking at him. You could have heard a pin drop. And so I'm praying. I said, "Whoa, how do I handle this?" Right? I know how McDougall would have handled it. But, you know, I'm not there yet. Okay, so fortunately, he went on and on. The great thing was that just before my talk, an internationally known geneticist had spoken, talking about the future of medicine, how someday in the future we'd be able to reverse diabetes through genetic reengineering. As soon as he had to, in his comment, defer to his colleague that he had actually brought him out, you know, big researcher type. And so when I heard him say that, I knew exactly what I was going to say. So I just kind of smiled the rest of it. He talked for like 4 minutes, right? I just smiled. And as soon as he was done, I said, "Well, first of all, doctor, I appreciate your position." Because we were all taught just like that. We were all taught that you can't reverse this, you can't cure this. He says, "But we need to make sure that that's true and that supports, it's congruent with the current medical literature. Because what? If it's not, we are stealing hope from our patients." He says, "And besides, I'm glad that you understand and approve that genetic engineering could potentially reverse diabetes, because that's exactly how nutritional medicine, when properly applied, reverses diabetes." And fortunately, that was the end of the debate. He just kind of looked at me and the audience, like, yeah. And so, but 2 days later, this is real important. 2 days later, remember, this is October 2004. I'm driving to work. Now, he has a dialysis unit right across the hall from our lifestyle medicine clinic. Right there, right? 2 days later, I'm driving to work and I hear AP News comes on and says, revolutionary news study that out of thousands of individuals that went through gastric bypass surgery, in less than a year, 76% of all those people had resolved their diabetes. They didn't use the cure word, they didn't use the reverse word, but hey, you know, look it up in the thesaurus, right? It's the same thing. Okay? And so it was in the Journal of the American Medical Association. Now, every time I give this talk, I have one or two people say, "Well, so you're supporting gastric bypass surgery?" I'm going like, "No." So I always explain. It says, what I love about these studies that come out, whether they're using drugs or surgery or whatever, if a drug can cure something, that means lifestyle and diet can do it too. Because it's changing the way the genes work. It's just proof that it is reversible. We can change it. And so, would you rather reverse a condition naturally than to go through a potentially life-threatening procedure? I've had friends die of just, they waste away. They just waste away and die. Yeah, they reverse their diabetes, but don't let the cure for diabetes be worse than the disease. So, my time is up, and I have another hour to go. So let me just run through these real quick. So defeating diabetes, we have to. There's great case studies, and half the book is on this topic. But it's, what do we do about it? We have to think good thoughts. We have to focus on first-class foods. What are first-class foods? Whole, plant-based foods, period. Those are first-class foods. They have to be the basis of what we do. We have to optimize digestion. I'm so proud Dr. McDougall had a whole book on digestion. I think that's one of the major issues in today's healthcare crisis is poor digestion. We got to fix those things. And the best way to start is with the right diet. Okay, get a move on. Here's a quick tip. For every minute that you walk or do similar activity immediately after finishing a meal, if you have diabetes, you can lower your blood sugars from 1 to 3 points on top of what you're doing with the diet. Okay, so why is it important to do it immediately after the meal? Because that's when your blood sugar starts to spike, driving the insulin up. And if you can blunt that, you've fixed the problem. Okay? So light activity right after the meal is the most powerful form of exercise. Okay, weight isn't the whole issue. You can reverse diabetes without losing a pound, but the weight will come off. Be patient. Okay, sleep is critical. Insulin resistance can, you can become more diabetic in a day from not sleeping properly. Okay, there's tons of research on this and epigenetic information on that. Stay well hydrated, soak up the sun appropriately. First line therapy is diet and lifestyle, period. That should be the majority of the approach. Fight hidden culprits, reach out for help. Don't forget that if you have been unable to forgive yourself or to somebody else, that can actually prevent you from curing anything all by itself. Okay, a lot of information on that. And then, so when it comes to your health, you're the chairman of the board. Act like it. And then finally, Dr. McDougall says, goodbye diabetes should be required reading for all physicians, dietitians, and others caring for people with both types of diabetes. Following Dr. Youngberg's advice will cure type 2 diabetes, and patients will be able to stop their medications. Type 1 diabetes will live better with fewer complications and on much less insulin. So thank you for indulging me for a few extra minutes.
Right.
God bless. Thank you, Dr. McDougall.
And
okay, thank you so much.
And believe me, we could listen to you for another hour or two, too. Let's just take a couple of questions. That means we'll have a little shorter break, but I know there are a lot of people. You could just give them some brief answers.
Hi. I'm not sure quite how to ask this question, but I've got an older brother who's about to turn 40, and he's compromised some things like his liver because of an addiction to alcohol, and he's got a compromised pancreas, and he was recently diagnosed with diabetes. Now he's almost 40 and getting, you know, bifocals. So for somebody that's caused some damage to their body because of that type of thing, will this, could they reverse their diabetes or...
Yeah, absolutely is the answer before I fall off the stage. I asked a question to the chief hepatologist, liver specialist at Loma Linda years ago. It says, what's the number one thing we can do for people who have liver problems? And he just says, lose 10 pounds weight. I mean, it's just so, so amazing. But the benefit occurs before the weight loss as long as you're doing what is necessary to get the weight loss. So if you change the diet, that day the liver is working better. And never let somebody tell you that your body can't regenerate. Even your brain can regenerate now, we understand. Liver regenerates, kidneys regenerate. Just stop damaging them and they allowing the body to heal. So absolutely, there's hope. Yes?
Thanks for your wonderful discussion. Just a couple of questions. Do you feel that the glucose tolerance test is a better test than the A1C? For diagnosing diabetes?
You know, I was so excited when the A1C was officially in 2010 placed as a diagnostic tool for diabetes and pre-diabetes. But if you look at the research, the A1C as currently interpreted is less effective at diagnosing diabetes than a fasting glucose, and especially a two-hour glucose. It's better, though, than waiting till your blood sugars are above 200 and you got symptoms. Okay, I love the A1C. I told you I test everybody because it's an early diagnostic tool to help people get to an optimal level.
And for people with long-term type 2 diabetes who've lost some beta cell function, is there regeneration of beta cell function for those people?
Well, if you haven't had complete loss, the answer is yes. But Dr. Herrera in Geneva recently published a study with animals that if he caused complete type 1 diabetes in animals, but then was able to remove the toxin that caused the type 1 diabetes, that within weeks, the alpha cells in the pancreas were transforming into beta cells. So the number one issue here is stop damaging your body with the foods that have toxic influences, and that gives your body the best chance to even regenerate beta cells to a degree.
On one of your final slides, you indicated that exercising early in the morning is better or leads to better results than exercising late in the day. Could you add a few comments to that?
The Well, first of all, the important thing about exercise, make sure that we got to do it at some point. My personal experience is that when we get enough sleep at night, then we can have the energy to get up in the morning and start the day powerfully with exercise. Okay, so I think the number one health behavior to be successful, get enough sleep, because that's what energizes us, it restores us. So now we can make good decisions about what we eat, what we drink, what we do. But for somebody with diabetes or insulin resistance of any kind, which is basically most people, the best time to be active is immediately after meals. I'm not talking about get sweaty exercise. I'm talking about just walking. Just be active for at least 10 minutes. I had a patient reverse diabetes. Hemoglobin A1C was 14.7. 7 weeks later, it was 6.6. Still technically diabetic. 14.7 to 6.6. And what she did is she walked 30 minutes after every meal and completely changed her diet to a vegan diet. And the combination of all that and the other strategies, without any medicine ever, completely reversed her condition. She's completely doing well now. Yes?
My friend who has type 1 diabetes wears an insulin pump. He's always coming over to my house and going, hey, let's prick your finger and measure your glucose.
Good for him.
But I don't want to do the fasting, you know, and wait till the next morning and all of that. In your test, you said you test them at health fairs. Is it just the change in blood sugar?
Well,
what are you measuring? I mean, can I
in the book, you'll see on page 90 that chart. And the see is that we wanted to make sure that you're not getting a huge spike after the meal. And so that's why I check it 1 hour after a sugar load of some kind or an unhealthy meal of any kind. And you'll see that spread.
Just the difference?
Well, total and the difference. Yeah, you want the fasting to be between 70 and 85, ideally. This is non-diabetic, just somebody that wants to be optimal. And the 1 hour should ideally be under 120. But for a diabetic, just do the best that you can.
So if you've had diabetes for a while, you're seeing lots of damage already, and you're on all the medications and all, and your family's resistant, and you decide, I'm going to make this commitment, how quickly could you could prove to your family that, yes, being on a vegan diet and eating the right way could make a difference? How fast could you see results?
Well, if you don't immediately, Dr. McDougall can answer this better than me, if you don't immediately start decreasing the medication, even on day one, when you do this program, if you just stop worrying about the baby steps and just get into it and do it all, if you don't immediately start decreasing your medicine, very closely working with your doctor or somebody that knows what they're talking about, you're going to be in trouble. You're going to end up in the ER. So the proof is immediate.
What a great delivery. Your enthusiasm is phenomenal.
Thank you.
All right. All right, we're going to take a 5-minute break, and please try and be back in about 5 minutes. Great job. Thank you.